The more did I start good morning. Good evening. That's all better. How many of you saw West Salem marching in the Oktoberfest today? Anybody? When did West Salem band go from wearing overalls? Anybody remember when they wore overalls in the Oktoberfest? It's been a long time since I've been back. But they looked really great. And I am thankful to see all of you here today on beautiful days like this. It is great to go in all sorts of other directions because our senses are filled with to do. But you have chosen on this night to come here so that you can be filled with that which passes all understanding and the peace of God. I am thankful for that. My name is Kris Bjerke-Ulliman. I am a pastor in the ELCA and rostered by the La Crosse Synod. I serve mostly as a supply pastor because I'm a full-time hospice chaplain with St. Croix Hospice, which is located here in West Salem. So it is wonderful to be here with you. Please check out the announcements on the back. But I also have a special announcement that Pastor John sent to me in an email. The committal for Bonnie Ender will be October 9th, which is next Saturday, at 1:30 at Neshonic Cemetery. And then a celebration of her life will be from 2 to 5 at Westfield. Okay? All right, so I want to make sure that everyone gets this information. Are you ready to worship?
Yes.
Please, thank you. Please rise. Psalm 8, what a beautiful song. Oh, we don't say that out loud, do we? No. All right, you may be seated. Let us go take a few. It's coming back to me. I was here in August. It's coming back. So take a few moments as we hear some beautiful organ music to reflect on what our psalmist writes to us about ourselves, our God, and our life together. God, our comforter.
Like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze on abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth of our apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves.
Amen.
All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. Let's pray. Sovereign God, you have created us to live in loving community with one another. Form us for life that is faithful and steadfast, and teach us to trust like little children, that we may reflect the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Our gospel today comes from the Gospel of Mark. Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus, they asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter, and he said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them. For it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The Gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Now, as I hold this phone in my hand, I promise you, I am looking at my Kindle. In 1981, Luke and Laura on General Hospital wed. Why I bring this up, you may have said. Through this show, a unity glow changed how we wed. How many of you remember General Hospital? Raise your hands. Got some General Hospital fans. How many of you remember Luke and Laura's wedding? Okay. Luke and Laura's wedding had a unity candle. Now, no one is really clear when unity candles first began. My parents were married in 1961. There was no unity candle then. By the time I got married in 89, unity candles were hot. And this is how a unity candle goes, if you have yet to see one. Usually after the vows have been said, the couples reach for their individual flames, either lit by their families. So you've got three candles, you've got a big one in the center, you've got two smaller ones. Usually the individual is lit either by the mother of the bride or by the actual couples themselves. And they take their flame, they put it together. They have one candlelight now to symbolize one flesh, that they have become one. And after that candle is lit, they blow out their candles. Okay? Everybody familiar with the unity candle? Very good. Since that time, unity candles have become big business, along with more symbolic additions. Thank you, Pinterest. Sand ceremony. How many of you have seen a sand ceremony? Same idea. Different colored sands, put them together, we're now one. How about a tree ceremony? I had that once. They had a 5-gallon bucket and they brought dirt from their family farms and put them together. I haven't thought about them for years. I wonder if the tree's still with us. These are just a few of the many ways we try to symbolize or show the bringing together of a new creation into one flesh. Now, in the time of Jesus, marriage isn't about love, but economics and social standing. A father would find a family with an eligible daughter that would increase his son's status and his status in the community and line his pockets with money and more power. Whenever he wants more or a better place in the community, or he doesn't like the food she cooks, divorce and marry up until he gets what he wants in class, property, and finances. Women are used in a system that does not recognize that women and children are created in the image of God. God calls us to treat one another with respect, dignity, and love. And in our gospel tonight, Jesus takes on this casual attitude of the Jewish leaders about divorcing a wife. In this setting, a woman could not divorce her husband. Only the man has the legal right to divorce his wife. They ask Jesus, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" And notice, they ask, "Is it lawful?" They don't ask, "Is it godly? Is it right? Is it harmful?" Jesus knows what they're up to. So he has them repeat it for him. Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her. Do you remember where that happens in our Gospels? Very close to happening. Mary and Joseph. Joseph had that option. That option was before him, and he thought it was the best option. And then God came to him in a dream, and he stayed with Mary. In this case, the law isn't prescribing divorce. It's trying to protect the woman by making the husband give her some way to be able to remarry. Because if not, she would have been reduced to a life of begging, or worse, to support herself. How many of you remember the women of the book of Ruth? If you have not read the book of Ruth, please do so. It's like, I don't know, 4 or 5 chapters. Really short. But in this book, these women, 3, Naomi, Ruth, I didn't write this down. It's not Oprah, it's Orpah. Yes, I have to go through Oprah to get to Orpah. It's bad. But, you know, their husbands die. And Naomi's like, go back home. Remember, Naomi was not from this, she married someone outside of her. She married someone who was not a Hebrew. She left her homeland because of a famine. And she went out. And they brought in women for her sons that were not from it. You know what happens in the story, don't you? Orpah goes back. She does what she should do to find another one, another man to care for her. And what does Ruth do? She stays with Naomi. She goes back. She goes to a new place, because of her faithfulness, because of her love. You see, this is what Jesus is getting us to. Jesus goes to the heart of the matter. He knows that their casual attitude towards sending a wife away comes from their hard hearts. They are creating suffering and they couldn't care less. We get that way sometimes. And he confronts them with the fact that from the beginning it was not the case. They appeal to legalistic hair splitting, and Jesus goes back to the Creator's original intention for marriage. God says that for marriage is to create one family out of two separate people. Marriage is intended to unite people in such a way to make it as if they were one person. But he goes even further than that. They want to talk about the law and cite an offhanded stipulation of Moses regarding divorce and remarriage, and Jesus appeals to the Ten Commandments. He says that for a man to casually divorce his wife is the equivalent of committing adultery against her. Once again, it's the casual, hard-heartedness, selfish attitude that Jesus addresses. When a man sends his wife away due to selfish reasons, he not only did her irreparable harm, but also violated the Creator's intention for marriage, and thus is guilty of committing adultery. Jesus is confronting casual, selfish, and hard-hearted ways, which many assume the right to send away a spouse with little more than a "don't let the door hit you" on your way out. That kind of approach to divorce essentially abandons all concern for the welfare of the other person, and violates anything resembling love or justice or compassion. Any behavior like this that comes from a hard heart undermines the well-being of everyone involved. And it ultimately undermines life for all of us. If one hurts, we all hurt. Give you a story from my past. Not my personal past, but my past. There was a couple that I knew, and he had committed adultery during their marriage. They talked about it. They were going to try to work things out. But there was one thing they couldn't do yet. And you know what that was? Come to church. Because they'd have to hide it from everybody who was in the family. You know what the church did? How the church handled the fact that they weren't coming? They kept calling me at about 10 o'clock at night, saying, what did we do to upset them? Interesting, isn't it? And there was nothing I could tell them, because this was a part of their life, not for public consumption. See, we know when people are broken and hurting. We often want to go in and fix it, make it all better, work harder. But ultimately, there are times when people need to just be loved and allowed to do what they have to do. And Jesus makes it very clear, that a casual approach to marriage and divorce is not consistent with the way of life that he calls us to follow. And when physical, emotional, and even sexual infidelity or abuse is present in relationship, the one flesh is actually destroying its very self. It's not how God calls us to live as a new creation. God calls us to live a life of doing justice, loving mercy, and walking humbly with God. That means we think about how our actions affect others, especially when it comes to our families. Jesus calls us to a decision to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. That means abandoning the selfish and hard-hearted way of life that so many have adopted. That applies to our marriages as well as to other relationships. He calls us to be transformed by the love of God, and so to live our lives with hearts filled with love for God and love for others. And that means living with those who are closest to us, who can sometimes frustrate and madden us with understanding and love. Right after we read this in Mark, immediately after this, there is the issue of children. Children, at that time and into the 19th, the 20th if they made money for the family, they are considered acceptable. So in Jesus' time, kids with dirty faces, dirty clothes, or fancy and clean clothes, came with their parents and they desired to hear and see Jesus as well. And his disciples can't see any value in letting children see Jesus. With callous and hard hearts, they try to stop them. And oh boy, is Jesus mad. Indignant is the word in Scripture, translated to indignant. And indignant means a reactive emotion of anger. Now, most of us try not to be reactive with our anger, correct? We're all taught, you know, you gotta not get your emotions involved. Well, Jesus' emotions are involved, and he is mad over the perceived mistreatment, insult, and malice toward children who desire one thing, to see Jesus. In our gospel today, and throughout the Gospel of Mark, Jesus is trying to retrain and reframe how humans see one another and how we treat one another. You know, we don't always do it as well as it could be done for a variety of reasons. On the edges of humanity, women and children, and for Mark, any outsider marginalized by ritual, tradition, ethnicity, race, religion, gender. Jesus says we'll find their place in the kingdom of God. There's a place for you at this table. Look at that. There's a place for you at this table. The reality of divorce, the reality of not being married, of not having children, has made all of us outsiders for a time. Jesus is calling us back to a created order, not simply to hold up an ideal vision of the perfect relationship, but to remind us that to be human is to be in relationship, whatever that relationship might look like. To be marginalized is to be alone. Jesus calls us back to our baptism. Do you remember that candle of the baptism? Anybody still have their candle? Yeah? A few? Please? If you've got a candle in your house, I'm going to give you a... I always give people assignments. Maybe that's why I'm not called it. No, I don't. No, I love you, Chapman. But light a candle once a week, every morning. When you say your prayers, light a candle and remind yourself that that light that's shining is the same light that you carry in your heart every day as a child of God. Treat one another as best you can. And always remember that God is with us. And upon his love and presence, we can and will stand on a firm foundation that no one can destroy. Amen. We continue now with our hymn, How Firm a Foundation.
Thank you.
you will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Holy One, you have raised up faithful leaders throughout history. Empower those discerning a call to ministry and all seminarians that they continue to be formed for the sake of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy. You have established a diverse and beautiful creation. Revive declining species and preserve endangered lands, cultivating in us a sense of wonder for the world you created. Lord, in your mercy. You desire for us not to be alone and to live in community with one another. Strengthen relationships between nations and peoples, that we celebrate and support one human family. Lord, in your mercy. You share in our experiences and struggles. Bless all who live with any mental or physical disability. Inspire creative community spaces and environments that are accessible and hospitable. Lord, in your mercy. You have established and nurtured relationships that extend beyond those gathered here today. Bless those who can no longer travel to worship with us, and those not yet comfortable being here, and remind us of their continued role in this community of faith. Lord, in your mercy. You watch over your servants to be faithful disciples of Jesus. Be with our confirmation students, especially Graham, Lydia, and Andrew, as they seek to grow in their discipleship, and guide their families that together they may reflect your love and grace. Lord, in your mercy. You promise eternal life to all your children. Thank you for the people of faith who have gone before us. Strengthen our trust we have in you, Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we drink, as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All who hunger and thirst, come. The table is ready.
Thank you.
Christ strengthen you, keep you in his grace. Amen. Lord of life and the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.